Are you sick and tired of being sick and tired? It's been said that an apple a day keeps the doctor away, or does it? It's time to get a new prescription for your life. Get ready for your daily dose of Healthy Talk Radio, the show that's empowering your health. And now, here's America's health and
health is your wealth. Thriving is more important than just surviving, and the only thing lost are those unwanted pounds. This is Healthy Talk radio that helps you get well, stay well, and live well. Lines are open, 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. What are you struggling with? Let's talk about it, your health, your life. Remember, if the body can get sick, you can also get well. Lifestyle is the medicine. So the choices we make every single day, they matter. You have to make good choices. That's what it all comes down to. You want to make sure you're making good choices each day for your health. Because, I mean, whatever you're struggling with, doesn't matter if it's diabetes, heart disease, arthritis, fibromyalgia, any of those conditions has to do with the choices that you're making every day. And that's why you don't see a bunch of 20-year young somethings sick all the time, right? Take some time to build that up. You think, well, that's just because you're getting older. Not really. I know plenty of people that are 40s, 50s, 60s in amazing health, right? So you can do well. You just have to make sure you make the right choices. It's what you do every day that matters. 888-283-7272. Give us a call. If you haven't checked out our health resort yet, you should go online, check it out, go to the website. You'll find out details there about the new health resort down in Florida in our headquarters down in Daytona, near, well, just north of Daytona Beach. But it's a good market. It's a great place to go if you have any kind of health challenges, say blood pressure issues, diabetes, you're overweight, you really just can't seem to get your lifestyle choices together. You do a diet, doesn't work. You've been trying different things, and the doctor just keeps telling you, you need to lose weight, you need to do this, you need to do that, and you just don't know how. That's what we do. We've got a whole team that we put together that can help walk you through a typical day and get you where you need to go. So if you need information, give us a call. 888-283-7272. We're going to Tiffany now. Hi, Tiffany.
Purpose of my call is to find out about hair loss for my 29-year-old daughter.
Okay.
I was looking for maybe some suggestions. Thank you very much.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that you have to look at in something like this, if she's 29, okay, and there could be many, many things going on. Now, she needs to definitely get tested, go to her physician and get some blood work done. On a regular basis, I think that needs to be looked at and explored, because hair loss at 29 could be thyroid. It could be a mineral deficiency, something as simple as that. It could be blood conditions. She could have an underlying pre-diabetes condition that's starting to show itself and not even know it. It could be autoimmune. Body could be attacking itself for whatever reason. So she needs to hopefully get to a physician and just have them run some of the basic tests and get a good idea. The tests don't lie, okay? Especially blood tests. The power's in the blood. So get in there and she can get that done. Now, you can let us know if you'd like what they find, and then we can have another conversation. But that really is what needs to happen first. It's not just, okay, your hair's falling out, take this. It doesn't work like that. I'm not a big fan of that. Some people will do, but I really am a big fan of doing the test, seeing what's really there, and then coming up with a good solid game plan. Okay. 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Give us a call or go to the website. So much that people struggle with, it's pretty amazing, with their health. And one of the big keys is understanding that you don't have to be stuck. You don't have to be in a place where you don't feel like you can get out. You really can. If you make new choices, doesn't matter if it's losing weight, doesn't matter if whatever you're talking about, if it's heart disease, blood pressure, cholesterol, diabetes, which we see all the time, people make better choices. You can get out of where you are many, many times. And don't forget, you can always shoot me an email and check us out on social media as well. On the website, you can jump in and be a part of all that we have going on. Dexter in Utah, he said, if I have low thyroid, what would be my main symptoms, and what kind of things can I take that would help my thyroid to balance? I have trouble sleeping. I feel tired. My skin's dry, and also feel a little bit anxious. Thanks and God bless. So, yeah, I mean, it could be a couple of things. All right. I mean, if it is the thyroid, the testing will show it. The one thing when you're getting blood work done is get your T3. So here's the different test. Okay. So T3, T4, you want to get those done, but then also make sure that they test your TSH, which they probably will, but have them check for what's called TPO antibodies. The TPO antibodies are critical because they can show if there's any kind of potential autoimmune condition going on, like Hashimoto's. And that's important because if you don't catch that and there is something going on with the thyroid along those lines, then it could be a big deal. But it could be blood sugar. I've seen it. I've seen so many people think it's thyroid, and guess what? It's blood sugar. And somebody's not completely in the diabetes realm yet, but they're close. So it has to get to a place, and that's what I was kind of challenging you to. It's got to get to a place where you know what it is. Because, yeah, those symptoms seem like it, but you really got to figure that out. That's the key. 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Give us a call or go to the website. Let's go to Mick now. Hi, Mick. Mick, are you with us?
Pneumonia, and he was treated, got out, and it's been about 2 weeks now. He's still got a lot of, kind of a little bit of residual cough. More or less, didn't know if there's anything he could do other than going back in and having it checked, but gets a lot of phlegm.
Okay. Yeah, if things are kind of lingering like that, again, when you go to your physician or have him go, I would definitely get, there's some basic testing to be done, but it sounds like the immune system's not building up. Sounds like the immune system is really struggling. And when you see that, you just have to say, okay, what is his body not getting? Why is his immune system down? It could be a lot of things. It could be he's not sleeping well. So you got to kind of dig in a little bit. And this is why when you call and you ask about someone else, there's a lot of details that I need to know, right, that's going on with them. So I'm just going to take some basic what-ifs, could-bes along those lines. So if he's not sleeping well, then that could be an issue. If they haven't checked his vitamin D levels, they need to, because vitamin D is going to show if it's really low, somebody deals with pneumonia or they deal with any kind of upper respiratory or some form of respiratory condition, that typically can cause some major issues. Like within the lungs, you can have lingering of many conditions when the vitamin D levels are low, okay? Then the other one to look at, and this is really important, to with something like the constant phlegm, you got to look at the color of it. And the color of it will tell you where the origin might be. For example, it might be viral, could be bacterial, could be yeast buildup that could be causing it. And different colors mean different things. Like kind of a green-brown color is typically viral. And if it's bright yellow, typically bacterial. And that's typical. It's not always. And then if it's like a white clear, sometimes it could just be a yeast or fungal type deal that could be in there. So I would have that looked at and take a look. And you know, those are kind of questions to ask that could make a difference and figure things out. But I'd get to let the doctor, you know, handle that and get in and figure out exactly what's going on. Let me know when that happens. 888-283-7272. You're listening to some Health Coach Radio.
To find out more, connect with OnCall Radio online at InShapeNetwork.com.
Lines are open, 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Now, I'm about to talk about something that's really interesting. I think women are better at this than men when it comes to it, but it's about being in the present for people in your life and for really for anything, especially for your loved ones, because this is something that I think many people struggle with in different ways. So like all of us, we have full schedules. We can, get into a place where you're doing three things at once, multitasking. Multitasking is definitely a better trait with women than men, if you look at the overall statistics. But when you give your attention to somebody, you need to give your attention to them. It's called mindfulness. And the idea of mindfulness is that life should be lived in the present, not thinking about what's happening tomorrow, what's happening 4 hours from now, especially when you're with people. It's one thing if you're by yourself and you're doing work and you're trying to make multiple things happen. But when you're with people, that's when it's very important to focus for what you're right in the middle of doing. So they did a study it's called the Center for Mindfulness and Medicine, a stress reduction clinic, and it was in Massachusetts, University of Massachusetts Medical School. But they said, here's the deal. They said, here's a couple things that'll help you stay focused in the middle of what you're doing. And you probably see this now. Somebody's on their cell phone, right? Smartphone, whatever. And they're working on that while they're talking to you and listening to music at the same time. You ever seen that? You ever go to a restaurant, see two people sitting at the table, right? Like maybe a date, and they're both on their phones whole time. Even while they're eating, holding the phone in one hand and not even talking. I've seen people sit in a restaurant texting each other, not even talking, while they're working on things on the phone, right? So it's being in present. I see, it really tears me up when I see parents on their phones when they're with their kids. It's like, it's not a good thing. You know, the technology's great, but it's not great for relationships in a lot of ways. So it's one of those deals where being in the present's important, I think, especially for parent-child relationships, but really for any relationship. And being in that place. So here's a couple things you can do to keep from multitasking and keeping people kind of alien and or keep from alienating others, rather. When you start a task, imagine doing it for the first time. So be curious, feel sensations like you've never experienced them before, and focus. So you focus on being in the present. When you're overcome with emotion, you can take a step back and trace the emotion's origin and duration. Okay, mindfulness teaches that recognition that emotions are fleeting, which helps to reduce fear and anxiety. So if you get to a place where something else is causing you a lot of anxiety, for example, it may be financial stress, or you've got a work project that's due, or a school project that's due, but yet you're trying to spend time with someone, you know, that project or whatever's due, or whatever the stress is, or lack of whatever you don't have, you have to focus in the moment of who you're with or what task you're at and put that to the side. It does. It makes a huge difference. And I can tell you clinically, you can see this. A lot of people deal with anxiety and stress that they don't need to. I mean, it's brought on by themselves. Many times depression, a lot of times, is brought on by themselves. It's not just genetic. A lot of times it's life that happens, no doubt, but it can also be a trigger in that regard. So you want to immerse yourself in your immediate surroundings too, not what might be, not what was yesterday, not what just happened when you're driving in, not what might happen tonight, but in your immediate surroundings, where you are right now, so you can focus on that. And that'll help. So just a couple little things that can really help bring everything more into perspective is a big key, because being in the present for people in general, those you care about, those you work with, whatever it might be, makes a big difference. And it makes a big difference not just for whatever you're accomplishing in that relationship, but it makes a big difference to the other person, to the person feeling special, for them knowing that you're focused on them. And again, that's a big deal. It's something that I think we're losing a lot of today that we don't have as much of as we, say, had 5-10 years ago, for sure. And you're seeing it. 888-283-7272. Let's get over to Paul. Hi, Paul.
52-year-old. Former smoker with COPD, and I was hoping for a holistic approach to help complement, you know, the regimen they got me on, you know, with some inhaled corticosteroids and also some nebulizer treatments as needed. I'd sure appreciate any help you folks could offer.
Sure. I mean, I can tell you a couple things that really would help. COPD is, it's a challenge, okay? Because typically when you get COPD, it's like you're waiting your time before you pass on, right? They almost call it just a fatal condition. But the big thing about COPD that we're finding now, a lot of promise with COPD is stem cell therapy. And it's FDA cleared. It's not definitive studies that it completely will, you know, it's okay by all the different medical colleges, especially the American Lung. But, you know, it's one of those things that there are lung centers that are designed just for stem cell therapy, and they're getting great results. In Europe, they've been getting great results for a long time with it. It can repair and regenerate the tissue. Does it work for everybody? No. Are there amazing results that happen? Yes. And so stem cell therapy is a great option for somebody that has COPD. And again, it's not evidence-based yet. I do believe that after enough studies are done, though, it will be, because it's just an amazing, amazing tool. Now, the other key is to make sure you're always constantly in a place where you want to keep inflammation down, right? So that's your eating habits. Eating habits are a big deal. So the anti-inflammatory-based diet, which is in my book, Empowering Your Health, check that out. You can find a good, simple, easy way to keep the inflammatory foods out of your system and keep it to a place where those kind of foods are at the greater part. And then, of course, the inflammatory type foods, processed foods, are very low. And again, with something like COPD, that's a big deal. I mean, that's kind of your foundation for all of that. Now, the other thing is L-taurine, all right? L-taurine is an amino acid that has been shown to repair and regenerate lung tissue specifically. So if you use L-taurine on a regular basis, it can help repair the lung tissue. And that's a big deal. Because they say once you quit any kind of smoking or whatever, take up to 8 years to completely repair the lung. Did you know that you can listen to the Asa Rx audio experience on Spotify and Pandora? For all the ways to watch and listen, check out our show page at asarx.com/experience.
To find out more, visit the show online, InShapeNetwork.com.
Lines are open, 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. What are you struggling with? Let's talk about it. Your health, your life. Remember, if the body can get sick, it can also get well. It's about lifestyle. So lifestyle is the medicine. So the choices you're making right now, they do matter. The good news is you can make better choices and do great. Check out the website. Have you ever heard of melatonin? All right, so melatonin is something that people take when they can't sleep. So if you walk down any vitamin aisle, you're going to see all kinds of sleep aids. Melatonin has been around for a long time. They say that American U.S. consumers will spend more than $437 million on melatonin supplements in 2017, which is up from $159 million in 2010. So there's a Nutrition Business Journal that gives us those stats. More than 3 million adults and 500,000 children take it. And what it does, I mean, if you have a hard time sleeping, melatonin is part of the serotonin pathway. So serotonin, if you ever heard of that, that's a big brain chemical that helps with depression. And so if taken at the right time, it can help induce melatonin, can help induce you into a deeper stage of sleep. So Australian experts called the increase in use among children alarming. And I would say that too, because as a child, you should be able to, I don't remember having a hard time sleeping as a kid, ever. Like, you just go all day long and you collapse. So a lot of people take it right before they go to bed as if it were a sleeping type pill. And Dr. Michael Bruce, who's a California-based clinical psychologist, specializes in sleep disorders, says it's not that simple. It works that way for some, but not for others. It was discovered in 1958, by the way. So it's a potent hormone naturally produced to regulate our circadian rhythm. And light is the switch that controls it. You know, one of the big keys about sleeping is at nighttime, if you really want to get into a good sleep pattern, you want to cut all the lights down. That's a big one. You maybe just leave a lamp light on. You really want the lights to be down, because the brighter the light is, the more it's going to keep the pineal gland, which is the skull gland in the brain, fired up. The more it's fired up, the less you're going to sleep. So it's a big deal. Since the 1980s, though, the dietary supplement makers have build melatonin and made it into a lab, promising as a sleep aid. It does for some, but not others. So there's been enough studies done on that. But melatonin does work for jet lag. It works from eastward travel, and they recommend taking about 0.5 milligrams of melatonin. And here's the thing. See, it comes in big milligram dosages. So some people are taking like 6 milligrams at a time. It's too much because your body produces it still, and you don't want to take enough to where it's going to shut down your own production. So 0.5 milligrams, 90 minutes before bedtime in the place that you're going to. After a weekend of staying up late, you could do about about 0.3 milligrams is a good way to look into that. So now the higher milligram dosages doesn't mean it's going to work better. Matter of fact, it can do the exact opposite. But we know that for the most part, long-term usage, if it's in small amounts, especially over the age of 40, can be done pretty well. The issue is for kids. That's the challenge. Whenever something happens, so here's the deal. As you age, melatonin levels go down. So for somebody that's 45, 50, 55, and they're starting to have issues sleeping, first of all, 9 times out of 10 when you can't sleep, it's a magnesium deficiency. So by taking magnesium before bedtime, you may find that does the trick, because we're so heavily deficient in magnesium, and that relaxes all the cells in the body, relaxes our system, our nervous system. That's what causes us to sleep well. So that's one thing. But the other piece of it that's really interesting to see with melatonin is that after about the age of 40, we start decreasing the production naturally that we make. And melatonin is important for increasing growth hormone levels in the body. It's just vital for so many different aspects to be hit on. So that's one of the big keys you have to look at in something like this, is to make sure you get everything you need and not using too much of it. Now, melatonin, again, clinically, it's used extremely beneficial for people with sleep issues. But it doesn't work for everyone every time. You just want to keep low dosages. I'm not a big fan of the high dosages at all. You got to maintain exactly what's going on in your own body system and still allow it to produce what it needs to. 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Give us a call or go to the website. Jessica says to us, she says, my husband comes from a family where most of the men end up with Alzheimer's disease. And I know there's foods and different lifestyle methods that you can use. What can you do? Well, a couple things. Alzheimer's is now seeing a pretty strong rise, of course, in diagnoses. But it really comes down to what you eat on a regular basis. The foods that will help support the body with Alzheimer's, especially any kind of neurodegenerative brain breaking down, for example, condition, is it really comes down to minerals. It comes down also to making sure your body's getting a little bit of everything you need with the healthy fats. So the healthy fats play a big role in protection. We went through that whole phase of low-fat, no-fat type diet. Everybody thinks that if you eat fat, you're going to get fat. It's not true. If you eat the right kind of fat, you'll actually get leaner, thinner, then you will gain the weight. So it's a lot of the excess carbohydrates that are doing that. But with Alzheimer's, they found that almost 40 to 50% of your overall daily caloric intake, if it's dealing with healthy fats, then you're usually going to come out okay. So that's things like fish oil, avocados, nuts and seeds, whole eggs. Those are all extremely protective to the neurology, to the neurological system. So just a couple of things to think about for sure, because that's a major player, and it does. It makes a big difference. 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Give us a call or go to the website, InShapeNetwork.com. Now, if you're looking for a lifestyle provider, someone in your area that believes just like we do, all this nutrition and lifestyle-based care we talk about, just go to the website. Our team members can always help you find someone in your area to help, to really take you from where you are to where you need to be, because you don't need to be stuck. You don't need to be in a tough place. You want to be where you can really thrive and you can really make it, and that's really what this whole thing is about. We want to help you get there. 888-283-7272. Let's get to Jimmy. Hi, Jimmy.
So I've been struggling with a lot of small health issues over the last 2 years, a lot of fatigue, also depression, and digestive problems, and I've tried a lot of different diets, like gluten-free, dairy-free, sugar-free, and eat super healthy. I don't eat baked gluten-free stuff. A lot of quinoa and rice to supplement carbs and stuff. And constantly gaining weight. I don't have a thyroid problem. I just had it checked. I have a small case of hypoglycemia. I do have some food allergies, nothing major, just kind of sensitive. So just wondering if I can get some advice about that. I've been struggling with this for at least like 10 years. I'm 25 now. So, yeah, it would be really great if I could get some answers. I'm really frustrated and confused.
I'm sure. Yeah, the thing is, Jenny, the thing is this, you have to look at when you've got multiple conditions going on like that, to get to the root cause, usually you got to step back and say, okay, what are the nutritional deficiencies? Like where did the body start breaking down in the first place, especially because you're 25? And that's a big deal within itself. So it's figuring out, okay, you always start with the digestive tract. Everything starts there, right? Powers in the foods that you eat, all of that is vitally important. So the foods that we eat every single day, they matter, they make the difference, and they play the role. So you want to get down and figure that out. So I'll get some testing done with your physician to check. You want to eat in a way that cuts out a lot of the inflammatory pieces. So things like, and again, things that are not so much evidence-based but that some doctors won't really agree with, but things like yeast and fungal issues that can build up from eating too much sugar or too much bread or too much pasta. It just happens. It can build up in the gut. And so by eating the right kind of foods for a period of time, it can clear those out and it can really help. So I would look at that piece first. And then the other thing is getting that blood work done, getting some lab work done to check the different and have them run where it bases more on nutritional deficiencies, where they can see the different nutritional levels in the body. You got to look at the regular labs first, of course. But then they can do things also like saliva testing. They can check for adrenal dysfunction. The adrenals are the body's stress glands, and if they're not working right, I mean, nothing's going to work right, right, for the most part. I mean, you'll be your body will be in a weakened state where it's not going to work that great. But I would also, overall, even things like stool samples, things that nobody would really think to check, I would get all that done so they can take a look and get a good comprehensive approach to where you really are. Because that's a lot of different things and variables. And usually once you do all those tests, it's like connecting the dots. And a great clinician can get in there and go, okay, well, this is affecting this. And they really understand the physiology. They'll get all that. They can tie it together and put it together, and it can make a difference. 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Give us a call or go to the website. And we're here for you each and every day. Kelly in Arkansas, I'm obese, she says, type 2 diabetic, and have recurring kidney stones. So what can I do? All right, so for the kidney stones, a couple of things. If you have them over and over and over again, it's a little bit of a key. Something might be going on, right? So there's an acid called oxalic acid. And the oxalic acid is found in dark leafy greens, especially like spinach. And if you have a hard time breaking down oxalic acid, if you eat a lot of spinach, a lot of dark greens, then your body's going to struggle to break that down. That's how a lot of the kidney stones can form. They calcify. So if you have low vitamin D, high calcium, and eat a lot of oxalate-based foods, you can make those stones. Okay? So you might want to check into your diet just a little bit. We'll be right back.
And watch On Call TV at InShapeNetwork.com.
If you haven't found a lifestyle provider, someone in your area that believes same way we do, all this nutrition and lifestyle-based care that we talk about, you can easily find someone to take you. We've got a team member that can easily help. Just give us a call, 888-283-7272. So lowering blood pressure is a big deal. It's one of those topics that affects many, many Americans and those around the world. But there's a really cool alternative type treatment that might even be in your local gym. that can help outside of the exercise equipment and the cardio equipment. But there's a great system called a sauna. And you probably walk right by it, see it, and don't really get into it that much. But studies showing more than 1,600 middle-aged men in Finland said researchers found that those who took sauna baths 4 to 7 times a week cut the risk of high blood pressure in half compared to once a week sauna bathers. So sauna bathing may decrease systemic blood pressure through different biological mechanisms. And a professor at the University of Eastern Finland said in the sauna, your body temperature rises, widening the blood vessels. And over time, this appears to improve the function of the inner inside layer of the blood vessels. The researchers explained sauna baths also remove fluid from the body through sweating, and it relaxes the body and mind, the researchers added. So the research team used the data from follow-up on the men over age 22 during that time and found that it was about a 46% drop, so almost half overall. So think about that. Think about adding in sauna. I really like the red light saunas. They're great. Think about adding that in on a regular basis and what that can do for your overall health. Pretty amazing. So easy to do and really doesn't cost anything. A lot of times it's at a local gym. Many gyms have them now. Hotels have them. So when you're checked into a hotel, you should ask if they have a sauna. So very, very popular. 888-283-7272. Let's get on the phones and go to Abe. Hello, Abe.
Have high eye pressure. No other health ailments, blood pressures or glucose or anything, but I have high eye pressure, but yet 20/20 vision. And the only way I know to keep that pressure in a safer range is eye drops, and I want to get off them. I take one drop in my left eye, which has 20/20 vision. I don't know of anybody on the planet that knows of a way to get off those drops, but I'm willing to listen.
Well, there's a couple things. I mean, the miracles of medicine are really happening right now. I'm amazed at what I'm seeing now in some of the research. But outside of keeping inflammation down through your daily lifestyle habits, which it sounds like you're in that path, which is good. And one of the things is making sure you're doing an anti-inflammatory based diet. Believe it or not, I think that's the core for many of the things that go on. I mean, eating equal amounts of lean protein sources like chicken, fish, beef, or eggs, low glycemic carbohydrates in the form of fruits and vegetables, and then healthy fats, your almonds, walnuts, cashews, avocados. All of that is vital for your body to have everything that it needs. And then once you have that foundation set, and once that's working well, then you can build another game plan. And I would look into this, okay, for that type of issue. You want to get a consultation with someone that's doing stem cell therapy. At least go look into it. Stem cell therapy is for repair and regeneration, even within the eyes. Okay, they're doing it now with macular degeneration, glaucoma. It's amazing the results that they're getting. Okay, and there's different types of stem cells. Okay, there's mesenchymal stem cells, which are the ones that they're typically using. You get those from the bone marrow, from the fat tissue, from amniotic fluid, from the cord of a mother. So those are multiple areas where they get the mesenchymal stem cells. And there's the embryonic stem cells, which, of course, have been said to not be used in the U.S. for a variety of reasons. So the mesenchymal stem cells are the ones that they're using therapeutically now in clinic settings. And it's regenerating, repairing, regenerating cartilage, muscle tissue, connective tissue. It's amazing at what stem cell therapy is doing now. So I would definitely get a consultation. Talk to someone that is skilled in this area that is doing stem cell therapy and really look into that as a viable option to get you in a better position, because you don't need to be stuck where you are. You really want to get to a place where you can do well. And the stem cell therapy is a great way to do that. So I would check in there. If you need help, just give us a call. Our team members can help you find somebody in a particular area. Okay. 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Give us a call or go to the website. We're here for you each and every day to take you from where you are to where you need to be. Lifestyle is the medicine. So the choices we make every single day, they matter. They really do. You don't have to be stuck where you are. We want to see you do well. That's for sure. Our lifestyle providers can help. So make sure to give us a call. Chandra in North Carolina, says, I have a wound that's not healing in my left foot, middle toe. The scab grows from about the size end of a cigarette to the size of a quarter. It kind of goes back and forth. I went to see the doctor. He said to soak it in Epsom salts, but it's still not healing. I went to a vascular surgeon, more tests done, and they said that circulation's the issue. I'm 73 and had a stroke when I was 56 on my left side. I don't smoke. What can I do? All right, so if it is a circulation issue, variety of things you can look at. For circulation, there is, especially when vessels are involved at any level, there's a root, and it's actually a leaf off of a root called rutin, R-U-T-I-N. Many studies have been done on this. Harvard has done some massive studies on it to find that it's an invaluable in wound healing. Comfrey is another natural ingredient that you can use, and they make it in supplement form, paste, liquids. But comfrey is really great for wound healing in that regard as well. But you definitely need to have a good set of physicians or providers that are helping you walk through that. Puts another hour in the charts. I want to thank our producer, John Garrison, our engineer, and the rest of the team. Go tell one person something you learned on the show. Together, we can transform the health of our friends, our families, and our communities. You're listening to the show that helps you get well, stay well, and live well, where we're diagnosing hope one person at a time.
This show is designed to provide accurate information of a general nature on the subject matter covered, and given with the understanding that neither the host nor the station is engaged with rendering any form of medical advice, diagnosis, or treatment. This information is not approved by the FDA and is not intended to diagnose, prevent, treat, or cure any disease.
To experience more of Asa Rx Audio, visit us at asarx.com.